design awards, which collects together loads of publications to do with best practice. And some of them are really interesting, some of them are obviously quite wacky, some of them are kind of very dependent on the sort of budget and the area, the region in which you're kind of moving things, but they all have at the heart this idea of creating, as kind of Sam mentioned, not just a building but something which is part of a wider place and has a sustainable nature to it and a desirability for people to live there. And I think what's interesting is, regardless of everybody's views of kind of central government and central government policy, which I imagine is probably a shared view across the room, is that they are actually trying to instill back into the housing policy this idea of beauty, which was the very first Housing Act in 1909, which was brought in for public health reasons to do away with back-to-back houses and sort of mass, like late 19th century terrible stock. Had this idea of trying to create a house that's beautiful, a home that people want to live in, and a city that's kind of dignified. And that seems to be kind of coming back into the agenda to talk about design quality in terms of beauty rather than just sizes or kind of all of the kind of more metaphors sort of. Again, so all the headings disappearing because it's white text on a grey background. But one really interesting thing, which I mean, this is a shameless plug, but we won a housing design award, which is a national award a couple of weeks back, which in our profession is like the most single importance of award in the country. And there's a really interesting spirit that was in the room, which was about, are we building conservation areas of the future? Everyone loves the idea of the type of house that's created a conservation area. That carries with it. There's loads of statistics about they're worth 26% more on average than other houses in the conservation area. And loads of bits which kind of say that we care and love conservation areas. And that's because they probably represent the best of their stock. And the question we need to ask ourselves is, are we at any point trying to create those for the future? Or are we just kind of churning out stuff to hit targets, to hit numbers? And certainly since the 2007-2008 downturn, I'd say that's probably not the case. It's probably just been a mass exercise in trying to churn out as much for as cheap as possible, not kind of necessarily worry about what the quality is. So just really briefly, I'll just touch on kind of several projects at very different scales. So the first project is just a huge project. So we're just about to kind of go out to tender for Guinness Partnerships on this, which is subject to a Homes England grant actually. So this is a scheme in Leeds, which is for 928 apartments, over 1,000 square metres of commercial space, 2 acres of public ground, so like a massive investment in sort of a huge part of the city across 5 versions. And the whole intent of this, again, apologies for sort of lack of clarity on that, but the whole intent of this scheme was, here's a load of apartments, this is intent from ourselves as design, there's a load of apartments, there's loads of spaces, but kind of what makes them actually be sustainable, and that means sustainable in the true sense. That's in, you've thrown a load of eco-stuff at it to kind of prove it means kind of betterment of building control and environmental issues, but why would anybody actually want to kind of live there? So across a series of scales of building, from 6 stories through to 20 stories, with all of the problems you could ever dream of having on one side, and listed buildings on every side of the side, with flood zone 3A, which means it's unlivable, essentially. So we had to pick the whole of the land up and through massive arguments across the Environment Agency about the safety and the impact on the wider area. We came up with like a very clear master plan, which was about continuous active frontage, so townhouses that had own front doors onto the street, animation and life everywhere, commercial spaces which occurred. Is there a pointer? Red dot?
Sounds like one.
Okay, so again, whilst not the most legible thing in the world, it's a series of 5 buildings, so from north to south, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and in between those, some major bits of public ground space. So as I said, this is a 6-acre site in the centre of Leeds South Bank, which is a huge regeneration project in Leeds that's going to double the size of this centre. And carved into the scheme was like a small intimate square which kind of feels very residential, very public complexity of the plan and the relationship between all the front doors, all of the entrances to the blocks, the commercial spaces, was like a very complex series of relationships which control traffic movement, which maybe conserves the bins without having like a tarmac road run through the middle of the belt, and we can get trees where we want them to be. And this is a scheme that kind of like, if anyone kind of knows these, there's some very serious issues to do with wind there and like a fatality that happened. So it's been proven at every level.
Very serious issues about fatality?
A wind issue. So they're very strong on wind, downdraft caused by buildings from wind. There was a bus that overturned in the city centre and unfortunately killed somebody. So it's a huge planning parameter. So at every level, the design has been tested to ensure that the environment that it creates kind of is a sustainable one, that it's a pleasing environment with no additional eddies, etc. And the only means we had of kind of looking at sort of complex schemes to build it in a three-dimensional way. And we worked heavily with Mark Burgess and Kris, who are the principal planner and designer for Leeds. And again, when it comes to design quality, I think a real factor you kind of need to sort of force into this is people having to have a relationship with your planners and your urban designers to actually see something that is kind of widely of benefit. So there's lots of bits about how the architecture is derived from all the listed buildings, but mainly it's about the quality of the spaces, the feeling of light and openness, the size of the units, which Leeds are very clear, they've got some very, very strong plan policies. So everything is national space standards, that's not debatable. Then it's a 20% improvement over building regulations, that's not debatable. It's 10% on site renewables, that's not debatable. And so the 5% minimum affordable housing provision, which is also kind of not debatable. I don't think they're exact about shared ownership and social rent, so I don't know the answer. Again, sorry, so tricky to see, which I appreciate, but the thing about accessibility and about lifetime homes and all those things, lifetime homes was, it's kind of really a bit of a game, a bit of a joke really, that never actually really produced what it kind of set out to do. What it set out to do was to create adaptable houses, but what it kind of actually resolved itself into was basically the size of a few toilets and a few missing bits of floor that make it actually take a hoist it. And I think, in our experience as designers, people's needs, their disabilities, their disadvantages, are never where lifetime homes can afford it might actually occur. So they always need an adapter. So I'd say, speaking as a designer, not as a policymaker and not as a planner, I would say forcing square meterage into something is the way it makes something adaptable, not having a policy that says.
About more properties being adaptable rather than just a few built specifically for. So that's a transform.
Yeah, which again comes into if you've got a square meterage in a property, it's adaptable, isn't it? Because things can move. If you squeeze something down to the absolute minimum, it's not adaptable because there aren't the functions don't exist. You can't maneuver the space. So kind of rushing through those because they're kind of slightly magical. Another scheme we looked at, which has now dropped in scale to, this is around 150 houses that we delivered in Rainhill for what was Helena and is now Taurus as a housing association. So this was a mixture of social, shared ownership and outright sale. And again, the premise was the same. Sorry. Should have brought my own projector. The premise was the same, that this was a complete, if anyone knew Rainhill and what was the name before, it was like an archetypal kind of sink of the state really. It was a full of maisonettes, no definition of space. And when we were doing the survey, I distinctly remember kind of people tearing posters and cars and stuff, and people trying, you know, so it had every disadvantage that you could ever kind of hope to see. And the idea was basically to transform the image and the principle of it. But what it did have is some fantastic opportunities because it had been there since the 60s. And so these things have sort of grown. So the whole master plan, so the design quality here was about acknowledging the good bits that do exist and how you work with those to create what are kind of quite convoluted streetscapes, but by being more complex than normal, have more interesting relationships, do different things. So this area here, which was the site of a few additional trees, became like a doorstep green, so all the housing was bespoke 2-3 weeks away from finishing in CrossFit at the moment. So it said, so interesting, the next three schemes, which I'll be really brief about, are all of the same private developer who has taken the view that you can't compete with Barrett because they can build their stuff way cheaper than you'd ever sort of be able to dream of trying to do it just because the economies of scale. And there isn't a point. And really, actually, the market kind of needs a different offer. So these developers are very consciously sought to build bigger things, to build better things. So floor to ceilings are better, windows are better, the scale of windows, the type of windows, how they work, the rooms, there's, you know, everything about their premise has been to deliver something different as a product. And they have seen, and there is clear market evidence of this, both this and the site in Liverpool that I've commented, outturns of like 100k more than the adjacent Bowway site, literally the house next door. They're outdoing it for the same kind of, roughly the same sort of sense of size, same type of property, just because the quality of the product is so rapidly different. And again, not being scared to approach things differently. So this, so the Bellway estate is actually here. This is the final, that's the final garage of the final house of the Bellway estate, Hawthorne Park, for anybody who knows it, Crosby. It comes into the scene. And these are 30 houses in a very tight grid, with in the centre, back-to-back courtyard houses. So quite a, you know, adventurous housing type. But those back-to-back courtyard houses are three-storey, three-bed, two gardens, garden first floor, garden ground floor, so they still deal with all the amenity requirements that house would kind of need. Meet all the planning parameters, and probably actually have more garden space than the Bellway Bank equivalents next to it. And again, so literally the house that's here just sold for £230,000, which was a four-bed detached, typical speculative house, which is fine, they are what they are. So these courtyard houses, which are three-bed and attached in every direction, are selling for £250,000. And their top four-bed house, which is the equivalent, is at £460,000. So just like a massive difference. Again, the principle is they're just different. They do things differently. The scale of the window that looks into the back garden just has an openness and a sort of vibrancy to it that you don't get with typical housing. Again, the ceiling height, whilst it's hard to convey in CGI, is this much taller than a normal ceiling, which sounds little, but makes it just a massive transformation to the feeling of space in that house. And again, so this is another site by the same developer that is completely occupied in Liverpool. So, obviously, as we know, Liverpool is not the most exclusive area kind of in the country. And again, this site had every single problem. There was a sewer, Victorian sewer, that nobody knew about running underneath it. It had a massive easement. It had a Victorian house on the centre of it. It had kind of grey gate trees that would technically all be issues, but actually just been transformed and actually made the best things about the development. So, this kind of slightly curious organic layout is the direct result of tree protection areas, easement zones, and also all the relationships that then exist between the houses. kind of spaces there that are being created. Again, all within the constraints of a budget, because everything has a budget, working on a listed building is not an easy project. And I think so. There's a really quick sort of snap view of all of that kind of stuff. I'd say the things that make design quality for us are not really what something necessarily looks like. It's kind of a little bit what stands it, it's kind of how people use it, and whether people actually want to use it, and whether people want to continue to live in it, which means you've got to get space right, you've got to get the environment to kind of pass around it.
Thank you.
Max,
have you
ever
seen it questions?
Yeah, of course.
Just two very quick ones. I was wondering where your role come in, and what this company could be for be advising our own companies on design. For comfort with it. Can I say one of the things I found has been difficult for the Ward Council is where we've had local developers carry out pre-planning consultations with the community, we've had real improvements in the quality of the design and compatibility with the community. Where we've had developers come in, this is what you're getting, take it or leave it, and then the planning committees are not having to go in the planning committee, and then we're told by the planners, it's simply accept any other rubbish because that's what the government says we should do. In some cases, that's the dilemma, but what I was wanting to really see is I think it's important not to necessarily have people have their own view of what's coming into the community, but actually talk to the community around and get them involved in developments. Actually have a real benefit when they will often perceive the problems that we would perceive from that, you know, boundary wall issues, drainage issues and everything. So I just wanted to see what your thoughts are on about how you involve the community in design, not just give them your view of what it's going to be. And the other thing is the issue of compatibility. You talked about conservation areas. I'm going to be honest, we've had some horrendous designs of modernist buildings put in conservation areas. Just antagonise our community. I have to say, I thought one design that we were suggesting we should improve looked like a giant Waterloo sitting next to a historic building. Absolutely horrendous. And one of the issues that we don't seem to be able to take the account of is what the new designs, how do we fit in with what the community that's already there? So those are the two generic points I'd like to make.
Well, quite simple. It's like an essential part of the design process. And I mean, maybe because for years we've done a lot of work for ourselves across like 25 years. So maybe it's more about culture than it is for other people, because via the public funding route, it was kind of always a necessity that you kind of had some form of public consultation. So maybe that's just become part of our ethos and the way we kind of work. But no, I completely agree. And again, you've got the tools to make that a requirement, haven't you? It's up to you. You're jointly, this city is the governor of kind of the qualities. And what I would say is, of all, we've worked across a lot of authorities, like, so, Manchester, which has a very tourist style, probably gets what it wants out of things, Salford, which is easy to go in, Medway, which is like a massive Kent, so again, subject to the South East and kind of like a very kind of clear, grandiose view of itself. But I would say the best single planning authority we've worked with has been Leeds, because they have such a clear view. And I think they've taken the view that, and it's clear, there's not as much development in Leeds as there are in the cities, but they've taken the view that they would rather hold out for a sustainable future than just allowing development for the sake of development. And I think, well, that's really hard, because that's turning away economics, and obviously I'm no expert in sort of the differences between kind of delivering development at any cost and delivering development at the right cost. But that is a hard thing for cities to kind of like to hold back from. But I would say in 30 years' time, people will look at South Bank region and Leeds, and that will be phenomenal, because things will not be allowed to get through. So just for consultation. The second one was about how something fits into
compatibility. I mean, I think we've often seen designs of one community being brought in on a new estate, which is totally incompatible physically, let alone the joinability networking with the current community, particularly conservation areas. I think that's some of our
section of walls, massive one, and we have to demolish them. And we have to demolish them for very simple reasons, that we couldn't get a service vehicle down there.
Yeah.
So there was one in particular that was based on the design of a Cornish fishing village, which was totally inaccessible for anybody. It won a massive
award.
Yeah, yes, away from the corner. But the point was, you couldn't still get a stroke, you couldn't get ambulance to it, you couldn't get a fire engine down there. So we lost a whole estate because of things like that. So it's not just about having award-winning projects, it's about where we go in the future and what we want, and ensuring that we've got the right planning policies in place to make sure that everybody in the city has a decent place to live. So most people that I represent couldn't even aspire to 250 grand, I'm sorry, I couldn't. So, you know, that is one of the things. It's great when people have got money, but if they haven't got money, we also need good design. So I'm sure you agree.
No, they're totally good. Well, I suppose first on the money comment, I guess, I'm not trying to sound particularly great or developing. I suppose the reason I got that in is because what always gets thrown in our faces, designers and architects, is you can only have the lowest common denominator because that's all that will make money. And I think that was the myth I was trying to dispel, not the fact that I think stuff should cost more and we should develop better things and that should cost more, because there's obviously a big social equation that the whole city kind of needs to kind of, you know, work into really. And to be fair, it wasn't very long ago that I lived in a shared ownership with my agenda. It's a reality of life, it's a reality for everybody. So I think, I don't know any big legal issues, but and coming back to accessibility, I wasn't trying to say that's what I was just kind of saying, that really, the only key parameter to make it accessible is to make it bigger than the bare minimum. If you make it the bare minimum, then all you've got is the absolute bare minimum rooms, and they can't adapt to anything. So you have.
So you're not having that.
Yeah, I get that.
So, and it wasn't anyway meant to say don't use that term. I was just kind of saying that because we, again, so as architects, we had to design to lifetime house rates, and it became the worst thing in the world. So all you do is you'd actually end up with a worse house than if it wasn't lifetime homes, but you had a toilet that was big enough to be changed to a shower that nobody would ever want to use. And it was that right intention, wrong outcome kind of principle. Whereas you make stuff big and it will work.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's it.
In design and the quality, I think what we should be also considering as designers is the environmental impact on the material that we are using as well. So it's at your hands, at your masonry, our environment, when you're suggesting this is how it should be developed and this is how we should be going forward. So I think my point of view is what starts with you start from your side in terms of suggesting, and then obviously planning will only then assist and help and guide. So that's the first one. The second one is about public realm. I saw you were talking about public realm, but you were pointing to something which is enclosed as well. To me, how can that be public? Public realm for me is like open, it's more spacey. Slide, that's enough for all the young people. It's not.
I'm not saying that it's possible to work to us in
terms of
development.
Sorry about that. Can I thank David then for your presentation? It's been really informative. We are going as a committee be having a bit of discussion around housing development models, so that's really important. Item number 9 is Liverpool Foundation Homes Ltd. Can I invite, Frank Hunt to give a presentation?
Supported housing, and we hope to work with the City Council to develop. sites to develop purely for development reasons. We're looking more about what the demand is, what does the customer base drive us to. We want mixed units, not developer-led, with varying tenders on sites, you know, homes for rent, rent to buy, shared ownership, with all those difficulties as Councillor has talked about. Market rent, open market sale. We think that's what makes us different in foundations than other developers in the city. And we want to create sustainable tenders that can evolve over time. And, you know, perhaps the best example of that was the rent to buy scheme we opened up in Harrington Road, 14 houses, most of them occupied now, and on a rent to buy scheme, with the aim that those tenants eventually will own those homes. And that's how they come into the scheme in Harrington Road. They want to be able to move in on a rent to buy basis and eventually own those homes. I think Mark can talk a little bit more about our impact on design.
Thanks, Mark.
Okay, good evening everybody. Thanks for the invitation. And just to mention as well, we've got a couple of members of the management team from foundations in the audience at the back of Charles, put the hands up. Not the guy behind. No, not really.
Where's your mate?
So yeah, from the outset, and the outset wasn't very long ago to be fair. Members will be aware that the company was set up in March 2018. The team started to come together over the summer of 2018. It was only really by around October 2018 that we started to really get together as a team. Some of the appointments, Charles in particular, joined us at that point in time, and we started to then look at what is the corporate plan that we want to take forward on the council's behalf as our sole shareholder. And Frank has outlined our core focus and priorities in the earlier part of the presentation. Kind of moving on to the theme of what tonight's all about, which is design. I think from the outset, what foundations wanted to do was to basically get involved in projects that were of good quality design. And we set about on a journey of really from day one, the same as a company, that we wanted to have our own design guide. And that is a piece of work that is currently ongoing. And we're hopeful that we'll report through to our board probably in October with draft of that document, and I'm more than happy to bring the results of that to this committee for further consideration as we get towards its conclusion. And obviously that ties as well into the local plan, which Sam talked about a little earlier on. And you know, what is good design all about? And Dave's talked a lot about it, Sam's talked about it as well, and there's been some good points raised by members in the questions. I think Councillor Qadir, you mentioned about space standards. Well, we already as a company have rejected, I think, 3 to 4 projects in our early days because those projects have come to us by developers in the city. And we didn't believe the space standards within them actually reflected the kind of space that our tenants should have moving forward. So we've got a very particular eye on that. And I think as well, you know, the comment, the using less energy to provide the same level of energy. This is all about the way in which homes can be designed and constructed and brought to site, delivered and then obviously occupied as a result of good design. Sam mentioned earlier on about making the place, the shape and orientation of properties, how they all sit together as a group of properties, and those are things that we want to do and emulate within foundations projects. In terms of the quality of the finish as well, good heat retention, air tightness, natural ventilation, heat recovery, as well as things like ground source heat pumps, solar panels, etc., really important. Another thing, people are now starting to drive cars that are electric, but let's make sure our houses have electric charging points within them, for example. When it comes down to recycling waste, let's make sure it's possible for people to be able to have a space to have the bins to actually recycle the waste properly. But all those hopefully will add to an overall running cost that is lower, and hopefully as well reduce carbon emissions. And that kind of falls in line with what we picked up from full council last week, which was the city's overwhelming commitment to our climate change moving forward. And obviously within this conversation there's a whole topic of modular build and other modern methods of construction. And being such a young company, you know, we're not quite there yet in terms of exactly what we're going to do, but we are on a quite in-depth We've talked about the pros and the cons of modular build. It's not all positive, by the way. You know, it's energy efficient, yes, without the shower, without. Nice and dry, so the builders don't get soaking wet during the winter when they're trying to build the properties. But actually, you know, the cost of these isn't as cheap as traditional build at this particular moment in time. It's probably a tad more expensive to deliver overall a modular property as opposed to a traditional build property. And there's also the lead-in time associated. So whilst you might be able to build up the 52-storey tower block in 19 days, which was recently done in China by modular build, somebody must have ordered that modular build years in advance of being completed within the factory for it then to be taken to site. So that is a key issue as well. So we are doing this fact-finding mission. We're on a journey with it. It will form part of our design guide when complete. And the one thing that we're looking to do is explore a number of site options within Liverpool so that within the next 12-month period, at least one of our projects coming forward will be on modular build. So opportunities and risks. Not an easy subject, housing, you'll recall from Darren Hardy's presentation at the Select Committee in June. All the challenges associated with the housing market in Liverpool, particularly in some cases, quality, tenure, size and share, age, a lot of pre-1990s properties within the city that need to be addressed, and Frank's obviously outlined some of our priorities associated with taking those forward. But it's fair to say that, you know, foundations need to have a forward land supply to make sure that we can actually get on and deliver some of the things that the council wants us to deliver. The council hasn't got an enormous amount of land, and indeed some of our projects, and in fact our very first project at Park Street in the Dingle, was a site that we purchased from the private sector. So in that particular case, the great news story is obviously in terms of the tenants occupying those properties very quickly. But the work that we had to put into that was to acquire a private site that was privately built on a deal that was acceptable not only to us but also to the council as our funding provider in this particular case. Build costs and open market value is a big one for us, and Dave kind of mentioned this a couple of times within his presentation. Build costs are steadily going up. The actual value of properties isn't going up in the same way. So it's becoming more and more important to take a long-term view in terms of investment. It's not that easy. You know, it costs the same to build in Walton as it does in Walton in Liverpool. You know, and you've probably heard me say that before. But in terms of the way in which we can then build those properties, take them to the market, we do, particularly in areas where